Well, hello, visitors to and denizens of the YouTubeverse. I'm John, your sociable hermit, currently on hiatus from the woods. In today's video, I wanted to carry on with the theme of some of the topics I've been covering recently, which have all revolved around the use of portable electrical devices. And by that, I mean things like the 600 watt steamer cooker device I have a video on, but also things like the power pack system. I have a video on different types of those, and I'm going to be talking about the EB3A that I'm using today, but also other things that might come up in some upcoming videos. There's a little 600 watt portable kettle, for instance, or even a folding e-bike, which that definitely deserves a whole video. It is turns out to be a very utilitarian, not just fun, device when you're traveling. It's easy to bring along with your minivan and really can be very handy. So the things I'm going to talk about today are mostly, for my context, electrical devices that I might want to use in my minivan when I'm out camping or traveling. But of course, there's a lot of other settings you might use similar equipment. So portable ham radio operations are another place where I use a lot of the same stuff. But any sort of camping or even home preparedness. Right now, I'm down in the big city of Vancouver, very far from being a hermit. But I'll tell you, only a few days ago, we had almost a 10-hour power outage, and having this equipment on hand meant that that really wasn't a big deal. So you've got these portable electrical devices. They're handy. You like using them. They take electricity from your power supply, your power box, whatever you want to call it. What I want to talk about today is putting the genie back in the bottle, so to speak, or what do you do to charge that power supply, that power box? Now, if you're doing this in something like your minivan, then a really obvious, simple choice is while you're driving, plugging it back into your vehicle 12-volt system. And they're almost all set up to be able to charge like that. Usually it's something simple, like a double-ended cigarette lighter type attachment. What about, though, if you're stationary someplace, you're camped someplace for a long time, maybe for a couple of days, or maybe it's shorter. Maybe you're just out for the day doing camping or ham radio stuff, but you're going to be using a fair bit of power, and so you want to be replacing it while it's being used up. And the device I'm going to talk about today is a portable solar system, or a portable solar panel, and I'm in particular going to be talking about the Renogy portable 100 watt panel. Now, the usual caveats apply. Renogy did not pay me or compensate me in any way for making this video, and I'm going to talk about it because it's what I happen to have, and I'm going to explain how it's useful here and some pros and cons. So, while we're talking about that, overall, I'm going to say that I like this panel and I'll go through why, but I will say that Renogy as a company, and particularly their marketing and sales departments, are a nightmare to deal with. Originally, when I tried to order this, it was about a $130 panel. They wanted $600 in shipping, and when I decided not to go with that, it turned out to be impossible. I tried for 2 months to actually get through to someone and find out what my other options were. And I literally got through to phone with people and said, "Oh, we'll have somebody from the sales team get back to you about that." Never got called, no responses to emails. Let's just say that they really need to work on that side of their business. Okay. With that out of the way, let's talk about using this or something similar to charge your power box. Right. So, first comment here is that you'll notice this is a 100 watt panel. Now, many manufacturers, Renogy included, make bigger ones. They make a 200 watt version of this. And for the power supply, power pack I'm going to be charging with it, a Blue TTI EB3A, it says it's rated for up to a 200 watt solar input. So why am I using a 100 watt panel to charge it when I could be using one that's twice that much energy input? Okay, well, A, the 100 watt panel is smaller and easier to move around. We'll talk about size and form factor in a bit. But the second point is actually a critical technical issue, and it has to do with some of these specs over here, and in particular, the current out. Now, it turns out that the power pack, the EB3A, has a current limitation as well. And if I went to a 200 watt panel, I would exceed the current limitation and I would burn out the charge controller on that power pack. I discussed that in more detail in the video devoted to power packs, but don't look just at the wattage. You also have to look at the input voltage and the input current that your power supply can take and make sure your solar panel doesn't exceed any of those. Don't even get really close because you don't want to burn it up. It's not really repairable on any of those. So let's talk about the form factor. So fold it up like this. This is about 50 by 60 centimeters. It has a total weight of around 4.5 kilos or just under 10 pounds. I mentioned folded, so what it does is it unfolds to give you your actual exposable solar panels. And it has these nice corner grommets for hanging it up, these nice solid handles. There's obviously some magnets buried here in the handle, so it kind of clips together on itself. You'll notice that the outside and the back is covered with sort of this durable gray fabric. I have mixed feelings about that. It actually is very nice for keeping it from getting scratched or scratching other things. It's nice looking, it stays clean. My only concern would be if you're using this outside and it gets rained on or something like that, it's gonna you definitely want to make sure this dries out and doesn't get all mildewy or crusty or whatever. There are built-in sort of legs, for lack of a better term, hold them up like that, and so you pop these out, and they have a little strap here to maintain them, and that gives you a way to fold it back in an angle and angle it towards the sun. And we'll discuss why that angle is really important. You don't have to use them all the way out. It's actually pretty stable across kind of a range of angles in between, but you can't get it really steeply upright with these. That's not stable. And if you want it further back than this, then your only real option is to lay it down flat. Note these are secured by Velcro, so those do tuck away very nicely. Same thing on the other side. On this side, there's a zippered pouch, and that opens up to the power output box. Now, the power output box here comes out these standard solar connectors, and then you can adapt those onto whatever you need. In this case, I've gone to the appropriate DC barrel coax connector. Make sure you check your polarity when you're doing that. But this is the DC coax connector that my particular power box, my blue TTI EB3A, wants for its input. Okay, now in addition to that, this also has direct USB-C, high current USB-A, and a standard current USB-A out. So, with nothing else other than, let's say, your phone cord or something like that, you can charge a phone or a tablet or something directly off this. Okay, it already has its own little charge controller on here, and that's a very nice feature if you don't want to have to use this. And the fact that it's a zippered compartment is nice because even with my coax adapter on here, this can neatly fold up. You can just neatly coil your lines like that, tuck that in there, zipper it in, and store this away. It's not very thick. The thickest point is probably down here on this, and it is really only about 3 centimeters thick. Now, in my minivan, this slides very nicely down in behind my bed. Behind the driver's side, door side, so it's completely out of the way. It's not seen, but if you want to access it, you just reach over and pull it up. It's kind of behind where my sort of my hanging rail is for my hanging clothes. Right, we talked about those adapters coming direct off. So the direct output's type C is power delivery 3.0 type, so it'll do 5 volt 3 amps, 9 volt 3 amps, 12 volt 3 amps, 15 volts 3 amps. 45 watts max on the USB-C out, and then the USB-A, the high current, the orange is 5 volts, 3 amps, 9 volts, 2 amps, 12 volts at 1.5 amps. So 18 watts maximum out through there. And then the older style USB A black, 5 volts, 3 amps, 15 watts maximum. And you can run more than one of those at once. You can actually connect multiple things onto here. Again, pretty neat. So basically, how would you set this up? Well, pretty easy. You pop out your leg, you unfold it, you point it in the direction of the sun, and you put it out. That would be with the legs fully back, but as I said, you can go to a steeper angle, up to about a 60 degree-ish sort of angle, and it's still quite stable like that. So to use it, you would just unzip the back, bring out your cable, and plug it into your power supply. Now, we're doing all this indoors right now. It's easier to film that way, but you can imagine how you would do this with this setup on a picnic table or a park bench or on the roof of your minivan if you're parked someplace. Don't try driving with it up there. Bad idea. Okay, big question first. We know this is rated at 100 watts. What do you actually expect to get from it in real life? Well, when they rate this at 100 watts, there's a couple of things. First off, I don't know for sure about Renogy, but most of these companies are actually slightly conservative. In other words, under absolutely perfect conditions, you might actually see 5 or possibly even 10% more output. But what are perfect conditions? Perfect conditions are you're someplace, let's say like Arizona on the 21st of June on a perfectly cloudless day with no haze, and you have this exactly perpendicular to the incoming rays of the sun, and I mean exactly perpendicular. We're not going to get into a trigonometry lesson here, but if you are not pointed, if this is not exactly perpendicular to the incoming solar radiation, the sine or cosine angle factor that's going to come into that calculation of what the drop in incident solar energy is not in your favor. As soon as you get that angle off being directly perpendicular, you have pretty significant losses. So, in real life, if you don't have this on some kind of perfect solar tracking thing, or you're not manually going out and tweaking and adjusting it every 10 minutes, you're going to have something less than ideal. Real life, for me, average conditions over the past, let's say, month, where I've been using this almost daily, I see anything on a good day from 30, 35 watts up to about 70 watts. And a lot of the time, averaging something in the 40 to 45 watt range. So around half of the rated output. Honestly, I still think that's very good because if I can get 6 or 7 hours of that, say, if I can get 7 hours at 50 watts, that's 350 watt hours. Okay? That's more than the total capacity of my EB3A power pack. If you can get 60, let's say if you can get 60 watts for 7 hours, 420 watt hours out of here. That is more than enough to, let's say, completely recharge my e-bike. It's definitely more than enough to completely charge my power pack. I've already talked about using the electric cookers in some of my other videos, but those run anything from 50 to maybe 150 watt hours to do a meal. So I could, in a day, get enough solar energy in this to cook two nice meals, maybe even three meals, if that's what I'm doing. So this 100 watt panel, without too much effort, and without living directly at the equator, actually does pretty well if you're not crazy with your usage. Okay, what about on a really cloudy day? Vancouver gets plenty of those too. Now, I'm not an expert on solar panel chemistries, and they've changed somewhat, but there are different types. There's monocrystalline, there's amorphous, there's perovskites, there's some new emerging liquid junction things. They have different kinds of behaviors depending on the actual chemistry used in the solar cell. And one of the things that differentiates some of those types is not just what the maximum yield per area is under really strong light, it's also how well they work in diffuse light. And sometimes, my understanding is that some of the chemistries that are the best yield under direct bright sun are actually not quite as good as some of the other ones at weak, fuzzy, indirect sun. And I think that's kind of what I'm seeing here. I will tell you that if it is a cloudy, gray, miserable day, I'll see as little as 2 or 3 watts coming out of this. 2 or 3 watts isn't really going to be very helpful if I'm trying to charge my power pack, because just turning it on and running a charge controller is already using a pretty big chunk of that, and it's pretty much a negligible charge. Bear in mind, if you're out camping someplace, that's where these additional USB ports on here are useful. You're out camping, it's been overnight, things are down, your cell phone is down, you don't have much sunlight, but you'd like to top up your cell phone. Well, even on a cloudy, miserable day, you can plug your cell phone directly into this, and that 3, 4, 5 watts will make a difference, and over a while will charge up a single small device like that. So a big plus to Renogy for including those direct output ports on here. There are times and places where I think those could be really useful, and that would be a major one. Okay. Overall sort of conclusions, and I would say my rating on this. Actual device, I really like. I like the form factor. I like the ease of transport and carrying. The thoughts like the little magnetic clips to hold it together. The overall look of it, and the performance. I would give this an A plus. I've had a lot of different kinds of solar systems on sailboats and on RVs and on my tool shed. I've been around solar systems for more than 35 years, 40 years probably. And for a portable one, and I've owned several portable systems, this is the best design, the best output, the easiest to transport. I really like it. I would say again, my dealings with the company themselves were not fantastic, but if you can find a way to just get the product and not have to deal with them very much, it's good. So far, the longevity of it, I've had this for several months. I've been using it really pretty much daily. It looks very good. I think it's well made. I think it's a good product. And if you're looking for a way to be able to charge your e-bike, your computer, all the other little gadgets you want to take with you on a camping trip or for your van life, if your needs aren't too big, this is a fantastic way to do it. And hopefully that gives you some ideas. All right, well, that's it for now. I hope you found that useful. This is John, your social hermit, saying goodbye until next time.